The world stalls, the color drains, and the sounds are muffled at the moment your eyes lose their light. There was a distant, continuous beeping sound, somewhere that dragged on with the moment before someone was grabbing Edril. The world snapped back into play. Then he was screaming, "No, no, no, let me go, no!" He fought and clawed against the arms holding him. A paramedic calls for the defibrillator. "Sir, I need you to step back." They're swarming your body, ripping your shirt, placing an oxygen mask over your face. And yet, you weren't breathing. You remained unbothered, motionless, lifeless. Edro sobbed, relentlessly pushing at the iron grip that held him. "No, I need to get to them. They can't. There was a wetness at his fingertips that he ignored. Maybe not even processed. "Edro," came a hoarse voice, Katsuki's voice, and then nothing else was said. His forehead fell against the back of Edro's neck, and his arms held fast to Edro, a vice grip. As though he was clutching onto his last lifeline, a single rope, as he dangled over a cliff. A woman barged into the ambulance as the other paramedics prepared the defibrillator, shouting, "I'm here, I'm here." Another yells, "Now, charging 200 volts, clear." Your body spasms, rising high and then dropping, rattling the stretcher with dead weight. Edro grabbed onto Katsuki's arm and whispered, "This can't be happening, Katsuki. Tell me this isn't happening." But Katsuki didn't respond. Again, charging 400 volts, clear. The paddles go down again, but no response. Edro couldn't breathe, like there was more carbon dioxide than oxygen. He choked, "Katsuki." But Katsuki was frozen. A statue at his back. Ezra couldn't even be sure he saw what he saw. Couldn't bring himself to look away from you. Again, charging. Clear. Electricity plunged through your body again. This time, when your body clattered down, the paramedic hesitated, watching the heart monitor with a furrowed brow. When the pause had gotten too long, Katsuki broke. He yelled, his voice throaty and cracking, "Why are you stopping? Can't you see they're dying?" The paramedic turned to them, his eyes holding regret. "Sir, I'm sorry, but..." He was interrupted by a beep. A singular beep, stopping the continuous. And he yelled, "Static, now!" The woman from earlier held her arms up, curled slightly down before her. Her skin began to radiate nuclear energy. Then, all at once, the light shot forward to her palms and then down to your body. It hovered, glittering like a fitting layer an inch from your skin. The paramedics relaxed, a few letting out a sigh and others slumping against the ambulance sides. Adriel blinked at the shimmering shield, confused, exhausted. What just happened? The woman who had released her quirk stood still. Her eyes, whatever color they had been before, had taken on an encompassing green glow, clouding her iris. She glared at your body, unflinching. "Static's quirk is suspended animation," a paramedic explained. "She's able to freeze someone in their current state of being. We froze them as their hearts started beating. So they'll be alive until we get them to the hospital." Abruptly, Katsuki released Edro. Tension rushed out of all his limbs, and he crashed to the ambulance floor on his knees. "Katsuki!" Edro exclaimed, kneeling beside him. Katsuki made no noise, but he was shaking. When Edro reached for him, he found that he too was shaking. He placed a hand on Katsuki's, trying to steady himself along with him. Hey, they're okay. You're going to be okay. Right? The lead paramedic replied confidently, "We're going to do the best we can." Those words didn't reassure either boy until he'd returned from surgery, stable. Both boys were silent as the doctor explained your status. That they'd done all that they could, and it was now on you to wake up. The quiet was stifling. Edro and Katsuki sat next to your bed, in those uncomfortable hospital chairs. Hours passed, with just the silence of the room accompanied by the monotonous beeping of the heart monitor. Katsuki and Edro didn't touch, the armrest preventing them. Edro sat closer to your head, slumped in his chair, his tired eyes fixated on your face, though every now and then they closed for long stretches and suddenly widened. Katsuki broke the silence. "You can go home and sleep if you want. I'm watching over them." Edro startled at the first sound in hours, then croaked. No, I don't think I could handle being home alone. Not knowing. Katsuki nodded. He understood that. Then there was quiet again. "I know you ate my spicy ramen," Katsuki said, lamely, without much thought. "What? The spicy ramen? You ate it and then panicked and threw it away, firework covered. I know." Edro's eyebrows wrinkled. "Katsuki, I don't think..." "It's one of the things we spoke about," Katsuki interrupted swiftly, "while we were down there." Edro's face relaxed. "Oh." Katsuki grunted, "Yeah." Katsuki couldn't explain how uncomfortable reaching out to take your hand made him, though he craved it. It felt unnatural with the way you were hooked up onto so many machines. You looked too fragile, too unlike yourself. "Sorry," Edro said sheepishly after a moment. "I don't care about the spicy noodles right now, Edro," Katsuki replied. "Yeah, I know," then said. "Funny thing is, we agreed to take that secret to the grave." He finished, realizing it really wasn't that funny. Katsuki's eyes clouded with tears. He shoved his hands into his hair, yanking at the strands. He wanted to scream, but stifled the urge by grinding his teeth. The anguish in his heart was exploding. Why did they give up so easily? Katsuki, no! They were ready to die. They were so ready to leave us, Edro. Why? Katsuki, Edro said softly, such a contrast to Katsuki's outburst. He set a hand on Katsuki's back and one on his thigh. "I don't think that's it. I think they were just preparing for the worst to happen. Well, I think it's shitty. Fucking shitty." "Yeah," Edro agreed. "Yeah. And I think we should talk about it when they wake up." Edro reached over to Katsuki's further shoulder, urging him as close as the chairs would allow. "Come here." Though stubborn, Katsuki leaned in, his head thumping on Edro's shoulder. "They're gonna be okay. We're gonna be okay," Edro said, as though he was trying to convince everyone in the room, including you. You were floating in a vast, murky numbness, a heaviness to your limbs like the beginner moments of waking up from a deep sleep, only to find your will to leave the blankets was zero. That feeling, but only 100 times stronger. Still, you try to pull up, dig through the numbness to find some feeling, and heave yourself off the cloud. When you crack your eyes open, the world is a blur of bright colors that make your eyes smart. You try to move, but a sharp pain in your abdomen has you halting and emitting a whimper. You hear the scrape of a chair, gasps, and voices, too loud, and everything was too much. A tug at your front had you whimpering raspily through your dry throat. "Don't you ever scare us like that again. I will..." You just make out the pale blonde blur, mostly by the voice, an utter weak, confused, "Katsuki?" before you're dragged back into the black. The next time you open your eyes, you're a lot more conscious, and thankfully, the world outside is a lot dimmer and easier to stomach. You blink open your eyes and recognize the familiar hospital setting, sighing a little at the irksome surroundings. Hospitals held too much anxiety, especially in the early days of being a pro, where you were here more often than not. Worse when Katsuki or Adriel were stuck in the bed. However, now you were stuck in the bed. You turned to your side, already knowing what you'd find. There, leaning against each other, were your boyfriends, fast asleep. You smile at the warm sight of their interlocked hands and Katsuki's head propped on Idril's shoulder. Your hands itch to take a photo, and you made to reach for your side table, hoping your phone was there. It was the slightest twist of your waist that had you gasping in a shock of pain. You cringe back, trembling hands crowding your stomach to try and ease the pain. "Pebble?" Your eyes flick up, seeing two dark ones blinking open. You smile softly. "Hey." When Ezra was fully awake, he tensed as though he would surge forward, but then eyed Katsuki and halted. The unspoken rule. You and Ezra had somehow decided that Katsuki was the cat of the relationship. When he fell asleep on you, you could not move. "It's okay," you assure him. "I'm right here. I'm not going anywhere." He reaches for you and you him. You squeeze each other's hands. The little warmth was pleasant to you, as though you'd been cold for a long time. You were about to ask Edro how long you'd been there, but when you met his eyes, you paused. In the dimness of the single light, you saw tear streaks shining down Edro's face. "But you did," he sobbed. The grip on your hand bordered too tight. "You were gone for... I don't even know how long you were gone for." Seeing Edro like this was heart-wrenching. Edro should always hold a smile encompassing happiness. Seeing him cry and struggling to hold back his trembles hurt. Tears prick your eyes and flow down your cheeks. Trying to keep the shakiness from your voice, you say, "I'm sorry. I'm sorry to have put you through that, E." Adriel sniffled, his eyes finding Katsuki and his interlocked hands. "Katsuki's mad, just so you know," he croaked. You huff a small wet laugh. "Of course he is." A vague memory plays in your mind of Katsuki grabbing your hospital gown. "Did he completely freak out when you woke up?" "Yeah, they almost threw him out the hospital." You cringe. "Man, I'm in trouble." "He's mad because you gave up," Edro said carefully, in a way that had you hearing the unsaid, "I may be mad as well." "I wasn't giving up," you tried to console. "I was just, you know, it was..." "You said I love you like a goodbye," Edro said suddenly, looking away like he was lost in his own mind. "I never thought I would ever not want to hear those words from you, but..." He looked up with glassy eyes. "I don't ever want to hear you saying it like that again." You let go of his hand then, biting your lip. "I can't promise that." "Why not? Why not?" "I was scared, Ezio," you say, unable to hold the tremble. "I could feel myself dying. I didn't want to leave, but I could feel it. I knew. I was scared that I wouldn't be able to tell you that I loved you before I go. In fact, I'm always scared of that. I'm afraid I won't be able to tell you I love you for you. If you were ever fighting a villain, I mean, the words would not leave your dry throat. The thought, the possibility, hurt too much. Pebble, Ezra started, this is the life I chose, E. I don't regret it, and I wouldn't want to do anything else, but I was scared. Katsuki said he wouldn't tell you, and I needed you to know. We know, dumbass. Both you and Andrew watched the rising form of Katsuki. His hair was mused, but his eyes were clear, as though he'd been awake for a while. You nod, not quite knowing how to reply, nor being able to speak through the burn in your throat. Andrew nudged Katsuki, looking at him expectantly. Katsuki exhaled dramatically, in a very Katsuki way, then said, I'm sorry about grabbing you like that when you first woke up, and potentially compromising your health because I couldn't control my anger. The words sounded practiced, lacking emotion if you didn't know better, but you knew better. Saw in the way that Katsuki struggled to meet your eye, that he felt guilty and ashamed of what he did. It's okay, you say. I'm sorry for giving up so easily. I promise, next time I'll fight harder. Though I gotta say, I really hope there isn't a next time. Ditto, Edro said, as Katsuki said. Better not be. Edro, give them some water, idiot. They've been awake for so long. Oh! Edro immediately reached for the pitcher of water and the cup. Edro was careful when he took the water into your mouth, supporting your weight in one hand at your back, while Katsuki called the night shift nurses. As soon as your throat was soothed and Katsuki re-entered the room, you looked to Ezra. Hey, E, do you know what the metal thingies in the concrete are called? Ezra sent you a quizzical look before asking, the spiral thingies? His brows furrowed in the most adorable way. Aren't they just called spiral thingies? Ha! Katsuki, told you not everyone knows what it's called. Katsuki narrowed his eyes. And I said that obviously Ezreal wouldn't know, cause my partners are dumb as fuck. Hey, you and Ezreal said in unison. In the end, you ended up asking all the nurses and doctors that came to check in on you, as well as a few of your friends who visited, whether they knew that the spiral thingies were called Reba. The medical staff was apparently more acquainted with such injuries than you'd believe, and most immediately knew what they were, though only one or two of your friends knew. During the duration of your stay at the hospital, you lost to Katsuki, but that didn't stop you from opening notes on your phone and beginning a little tally of how many people knew and didn't, because in the end, you decided not to surrender yet. You promised to fight, right? Katsuki woke, gasping into the crisp night air and jolting defensively at the hand holding onto his arm. His hand thrust out instinctively, readying an explosion. He swung at the unknown figure, then abruptly stopped, facing Ezreal. His gaze flicked around him, and he realized with relief that he was in his bedroom. Katsuki lowered his hand, extinguishing the heat buildup. He gulped for air, trying to steady his racing heart and the pure terror it fueled in his veins. Okay, it's okay, they're safe, we're okay. It was Ezreal's voice, soothing and comforting and easing the unbearable tightness in his chest, threatening to cut off his oxygen. I'm fine, Katsuki mumbled after he finally resumed some form of stability. Ezreal relaxed against the bed, but did not let go of Katsuki's hand. Was it about... Yeah, Katsuki said in a clipped tone. There was silence before Katsuki asked, did I wake you? Ezreal hesitated, gazing down at you. No, he shifted a little. Every time I close my eyes, I see the ambulance. And I swear that they're not breathing anymore. I feel like I can't be okay unless I'm watching them breathe. That sounds crazy. And yet, it made perfect sense to Katsuki, because at that moment, you'd been staring down at your sleeping form, gaining a little more strength each time you inhaled. It's not crazy at all, Katsuki said quietly. There was a time lapse where they were at peace in the bubble of their room, watching you inhale and exhale. The small moment when they were calm despite the exhaustion surrounding them. Then it was broken by a sharp inhale that made them both startle. You gasped, eyes still closed. Katsuki was already pulling back the blanket, checking your wound to see if it had somehow reopened. Ezio was at your side, rubbing a hand over your arm, glancing at Katsuki with worried, questioning eyes. You whined, almost like you were in pain, and then sobbed out, I can't breathe, Katsuki. You were jerking back, gasping for breath. Katsuki, it hurts, Katsuki. Ezio glanced at Katsuki, who had latched onto your hand, squeezing tightly. Hey, I'm here, dumbass. Breathe. Ezio clutched your other hand. It's okay, Pebble. We're right here. It's okay now. Just breathe for us. Your eyebrows crinkle as though confused. Ezio. The mention of Ezio calmed your sleeping self until your breathing slowed and you were back to slumberland, peaceful once again. Ezio's free hand, not holding your hand, was patting your hair. He looked at Katsuki, who was unnervingly quiet, his eyes shining like rubies. Cat, Ezio began. Katsuki's tongue flicked over his canine, which would have been a sign of annoyance if he didn't look as though he was fighting hard not to cry. Do you think? Katsuki glared at your face. You think they were in that much pain before? Ezio never stopped patting your hair. Katsuki, it's okay now. There's no use dwelling on it. We have to heal. Katsuki just nodded, not looking up. Ezio exhaled slowly, quietly, before urging. Katsuki, come on, let's get some sleep. Come here. Ezio tugged lightly on Katsuki's arm, pulling him halfway over you, before easing him onto your chest. His limbs held little resistance. Katsuki settled onto your chest, with only his head resting on your heartbeat. Ezio lay close, his large arms encircling you two, each claiming a head to pet. They were so close, they could each hear the air rushing in and out of their lungs. Normal, steady, and strong. When you woke groggily from your heavy sleep, you were a little surprised to see Katsuki on you. While it was not unusual for you all to cuddle, Katsuki preferred being Big Spoon. Nevertheless, feeling his spiky yet fluffy hair nuzzle gently onto your skin was a pleasant experience. Ezio was close as well, a large arm draped over the two of you protectively. You could almost see a shield attached to his beefy arm. A warmth blooms at your chest. This little moment was just the confirmation that you needed to feel your near-death experience was over, at least until the next villain attack. The nightmare that had flounced into your head had been brief, but no less terrifying. That you had landed back at the bottom of the trench, with metal bars stuck in your torso. Only in your dream, the chunk of concrete had descended onto your chest. You couldn't breathe. You cried for Katsuki, who sat next to you, saying things you couldn't understand. You couldn't reach for him. Your hands would be blocked by a barrier every time you tried. But you heard Ezio, and in the deepness of your subconscious, you knew Ezio did not belong at that moment. Then, the terrible dream had faded, bringing about a comforting nothingness until morning arrived. With the warmth of your companions, you couldn't imagine a better way to chase away the uncertainty of the future. At the very least, you were together now, enjoying the comfort of each other's warmth and presence. Their breaths and snores lulled you back into a blissful half-sleep. Screw it. You all worked hard, so you were allowed to sleep in once in a while.